Hello and welcome to the Booster Pack. My name is Rands and this is the show where we unwrap the stories and crack the mysteries of collectible games each and every episode. And today we are going to be doing something that we often do on this show, which is walking back through the pages of collectible game history to uncover the origin and impact of one very specific game. In this case, it is Blood Wars. Now, Blood Wars may not be the most familiar title to many in the contemporary collectible gaming space, but I promise you when it was launched in March of 1995, it indeed had some sort of influence because it featured a slew of very unique mechanics, and it also had an eclectic collection of art from some of fantasy and role-playing's greatest and most prolific illustrators, including Tony D. Trelizzi. Now, to escort us back on this journey to uncover how the inception of Blood Wars came about and how it was introduced into the hobby game market way back when, we have somebody who's not only familiar with their Blood Wars history, well, as its lead designer and its creator, they actually lived that history. Now, before we introduce them, I would be remiss to simply paint our guest today as somebody who created the Blood Wars card game because their influence in the hobby gaming space stretches far further. Because you see, our guest at one point or another has either authored or edited some of the biggest titles in roleplay gaming. Those titles include the Alternity Star Drive system, the Buck Rogers High Adventure RPG, and the incredibly memorable Marvel Super Heroes role-playing game. However, their tenure in gaming didn't stop there because they also worked for many years full-time for two of the biggest hobby gaming companies the world has ever known. First at TSR and then onto Wizards of the Coast. And it was there at those big companies that they were able to release their most lauded and loved works for the granddaddy of all RPG systems, Dungeons & Dragons. Yes, our guest for D&D has created many things, but among them are some loved and acclaimed Forgotten Realms books, including The Sea of Fallen Stars, City of Splendor, and The Lands of Intrigue. As well, our guest also helped Wizards of the Coast relaunch Dungeons & Dragons way back in 2000 with D&D 3rd Edition. So I am ecstatic to finally welcome to the Booster Pack somebody who is a gamer, a teacher, an author, a designer, and of course, a world builder. It is Stephen E. Schend. Stephen, how do you do, bud?
I'm blushing from that intro. Thank you very much.
Oh, please, shucks. That's merely a scraping the surface of all the things you've done in hobby gaming. But thank you. Thank you so much for joining me.
I'm glad to be here.
Excellent. So let's jump back before even all of that amazing work and sort of like dig into your personal history, your chapter one, so to speak. Do you want to tell me about what you gravitated towards when it came to geekdom and gaming in the first place and what really got you interested in this side of hobby gaming?
Well, going far enough back, comic books is where it's, well, before even comic books, I was watching monster movies and horror movies with my dad on, you know, Saturday nights or whenever you could. So that pulled me into it. And then I found some comic books. I think I started reading some of the horror comics from the 70s because those tied in with the movies we'd be watching. And then I think I caught some Fantastic Four comic that looked so strange. I really needed to read it to figure out what was going on. No, I never crawled back out of that rabbit hole.
That's awesome. So how do you go from comic books then into role-playing gaming? Like, how do you first discover that hobby?
Well, let's see. I think I got the Holmes edition of D&D with the Dave Sutherland full-color cover, but the blue booklets inside. That was the first D&D set I had. I got it for a birthday. I read it a couple of times and could not wrap my brain around it. And it wasn't until, you know, a friend of the family mentioned that he played D&D and, can you explain it to me? Because this doesn't make any sense. He's like, yeah, you really do need someone to teach it to you because it doesn't make sense just reading it on the page. So, okay, one thing led to another. I finally grokked what was going on and met some friends and, you know, played all the way through high school and bits and pieces in college. And it was shortly after college that I stumbled into, you know, the luck and timing to get into TSR in 1990.
So let's talk about that. Tell me all about it. You said it was luck. You said it was good fortune. Maybe you rolled a natural 20 in that case. Tell me all about how you got to TSR.
Yeah, I graduated in early 1989 with a teaching degree and spent the next 6 to 8 months applying for every teaching job I could. And just was not getting enough traction there and was getting frustrated. So one day I'm sitting there decompressing, reading Dragon magazine as it happened, and thought, why not? I'll just send in a cold resume to the games department and into Dragon. And, you know, the worst they can do is just ignore it, you know. So I sent in one to Roger Moore at Dragon, and I sent another into, I think it was Karen Boomgarden, because she was the head editor on the last three or four things I was looking at. So I went into her, and by utter dumb luck, they happened to be looking for an assistant editor at Dragon. So within 2 weeks of that letter going out, I got a call to interview. I did not get that job. Dale Donovan got that job over me. But it was apparently enough that I did get a call back to go and interview for a games division editorial slot. And it took a few months more, but I started there in February of 1990. And so, yeah, it was just, a cold thing, because I was frustrated that I wasn't hearing back from all the teaching positions I was trying to get in at.
What an inspirational story for anybody out there wanting to get in. You know, it doesn't hurt to try is basically the philosophy I'm hearing there. And I think that that's an absolute great way to signify getting into something that you just absolutely loved. What an enthusiast. Now, the first couple of years, obviously, at TSR, just give me a quick idea of the sort of roles and responsibilities you had.
The first thing I worked on was Spelljammer.
That's so cool.
Yep. Edited a couple of those adventures. And then did some 25C stuff, which was the Buck Rogers with AD&D rules.
So you're working on these amazing titles, these role-playing game titles, and all of a sudden the industry goes through a big change, not by something that industry leader TSR had done, but a small Seattle-based company, Wizards of the Coast. This game drops called Magic the Gathering, and it sort of changes hobby gaming landscape pretty much forever. Do you want to tell me when you first, I assume, heard of Magic first as far as collectible games go, and what impact that had not only on you, but at the offices at TSR when it very first came out?
I wasn't terrifically aware of it right at first, but then, you know, I was at the time the type to put in a 50 to 60 hour work week and not, you know, bring my head up too much. So it was very focused on what I was doing, but I did start hearing about Magic. The first time it really hit me, I think I was at a convention. I cannot remember the name, but I know it was in 1994. And because we had just released the Buck Rogers High Adventure game, but we also had just released Dragon Strike, if you remember that one.
Right. I remember that video. I think there's some really good eagle-eyed people can spot some great TSR staffers in that one.
Yeah, well, in any case, it was a convention. It was a good convention, but at the end of it, the usual sort of, okay, we're going to swap products so we'd have less stuff to take home. And the folks at the Wizards booth wanted to get some D&D stuff and other, and so they were willing to trade us for Magic cards, and I hadn't played, didn't have any, so I think I ended up trading a bunch of Marvel boxes, some of the Buck Rogers High Adventure, and some random other game stuff, and we got a couple of sealed boxes. So I just split all the cards amongst the people at the booth, and we started playing them, but I really didn't take off as a player until I was a couple of months after that, and Jim Ward and the sales department started their sneaky, if you send us a deck of Magic cards, we'll send you two Spellfire decks. I just remember a day where I got pulled off of my immediate project, and Jim hands me a massive box filled with Magic cards. He's like, here's a sheet. These are the cards I need. Go through, keep any of the other ones you want, but grab any of these and get them to me.
What a day at work.
So I ended up with a stack like that of Plague Rats, which was my go-to for a little while.
Now, we should mention as well, back then, Plague Rats weren't limited to four, so you could play with as many as you wanted. Now, it was so interesting that you mentioned there that Jim was talking about, you know, having that special offer where Spellfire, if you traded in, you know, a deck of Magic cards, you'd get Spellfire cards for it. In fact, if anybody's interested in more details on that, Jim talks about that in a previous episode we did on this podcast. We'll link it in the description if anyone's interested to check that out as well. But that's so amazing that even in the TSR offices, this new gaming phenomenon is starting to take hold amongst all of you guys. So tell me, at the time, it sounds like while you were getting familiar with Magic, TSR was already in the works of creating something like Spellfire, which was, you know, this second ever collectible card game to hit the market. Tell me about like what your involvement with that game was. What did you know about it? And, you know, what memories do you have of Spellfire?
I have to say, I think I was on another pressing deadline, which is why I wasn't involved that much at all with Spellfire. I might have gotten in maybe one or two playtest games over a lunch break or something like that. But so my involvement with Spellfire was pretty minimal, unfortunately, because it certainly was a fun game and a good group of people that were developing it. I didn't get pulled into the card game stuff deeply until, you know, again, just by some freak happenstance of timing. I got pulled into doing Blood Wars because I was the one guy on staff who had a slight bit of wiggle room in in my schedule. She's like, oh, okay, so you've got 2.5 weeks and you need to deliver a card game.
Wow. So we're going to go with that. That's an amazing feat. So we're going to circle back to the 2.5 weeks in just a second. But before we move away from Spellfire, it sounds like, you know, you might have rolled another natural 20 there, depending on your perspective. But I did want to ask, you know, you've started to play Spellfire. Obviously, Spellfire hits the market. It's you know, in competition. It's the first game to be in competition with Magic. What is the attitude about Spellfire and collectible games around the TSR offices? Are they impressed with what Spellfire is doing? Are they excited? Obviously, you know, you get tagged to do another game altogether that we're going to talk about in just a second. But like, what is the fervor in this particular sort of 94 period where there's only really two games, Magic and Spellfire? What is the higher ups, or your opinion or memory of the higher ups at TSR thinking at this point?
What I can remember, and again, this is me being still somewhat low on the totem pole. I didn't have any major, you know, no titles to speak of. I was just, you know, down in the trenches, getting the work done. But I had the understanding that it was the suits, as we lovingly called them. they had it in their heads that their main competition was video games and electronic games, which was why they went the route of Dragon Strike to both have an intro for D&D and role-playing, but to compete directly with people that were, you know, more enamored of special effects and video stuff. So there was that. And, during that time, there were two or three different attempts to find better ways to teach D&D to new players. And all of them had some good points to them, but you still ended up a lot of times needing someone to walk you through it.
Well, much like you had done decades earlier, right? Like not much had changed in that space.
Now, granted, the way that the books are written is vastly better than the first few editions of D&D, because those, if you didn't have that window of how do war games and miniatures games work, then that's why a lot of the terminology that Gary had in those books didn't make a lick of sense to somebody who had no experience with it. But now I think, you know, fans now have it great because you can just go to YouTube or wherever and you can find a video with, you know, a walkthrough, you know, giving you the tutorials for that sort of stuff. But again, looping back to your question originally, I think the main thing, again, they were looking for ways to make it easier to get more players playing D&D and less players spending money on video games. And I think in some ways they were blindsided by Magic and all of the collectible card games, because it wasn't expected in any way, and it wasn't a typical sort of a venue that it would come from, because card production wasn't, you know, once you got, I thought it was a little more expensive than it actually ended up being. And it could be that, you know, because of suddenly the influx of companies wanting to make full color glossy cards, you know, that may have changed the matter and made things cheaper. But so it's, you know, when Spellfire went out and made, I think, I happened to watch your interview with Jim Ward this morning. So who is, what was it, 30 million in its first year for profit, which, yeah, that, and I think that's why they started up and they said, okay, but well, we need another one of these. We need to make more money, so let's do another card game, you know?
So that's so interesting. So let's talk about it a little bit. And I agree with your idea there that, you know, it's so easy to see video games coming. They'd sort of been percolating for the entire decade of the 80s, you know, with home consoles, you know, Ataris and television and all that sort of stuff. But Magic the Gathering comes out and is an overnight success, essentially, you know, within sort of 6 to 12 months. It's basically everything that hobby gaming is really talking about as far as, you know, the fervor of game stores and card shops and stuff like that. In a previous interview I did, you know, somebody likened it to the craze that we felt through sports cards and stuff like that. Now, I do want to talk about the fact that all of a sudden, you know, TSR's idea was, hey, we've got this new Planescape, or relatively new at the time, RPG, and then we want to build another card game out of that rather than build into the original Spellfire. So let's talk about Spellfire and how it relates to what ended up becoming Blood Wars, because I'm really curious. Obviously, TSR had success, you know, $30 million for a card game. Was there a reason that you think that they decided not to just incorporate Planescape into Spellfire rather start a whole new system, which you ended up releasing only 9 months after Spellfire released?
Yeah, I think their main idea behind why we went with a different thing was both from a sales tactic, it's not just, oh, here's one more thing. It's something that's new, that it's its own product SKU, and it could be, well, for lack of a better phrase, it's another page in the sales and marketing pitch rather than just a footnote on the same page. So it says, yes, we are so convinced that we can do great card games that we've got two on the going right now, not just one.
Well, that's so interesting. I love that. I love that perspective from a business angle, because like you said, there was such fervor in the collectible game space at the time. People were snapping up everything they could get their hands on, looking for the next Magic, obviously. So let's really dig into the origins and history of what is Blood Wars.
Don't dig too deep. It's not that.
I can't wait to find out how deep this this well goes. So tell me, what do you remember about the first time this project was brought to you? You know, you sort of snuck in there before and said you had 2 weeks to design it. Tell me all about what you remember from the very earliest mention of this second Magic TSR CCG to, you know, what you remember about the initial design process and even choosing why Blood Wars or Planescape would be the setting for this game.
Planescape was both the newest release that TSR had done for AD&D, or D&D. Yeah, it was still AD&D in second edition. But it was dominating an awful lot of the discussion that we were getting from fans and also hearing through the distributors and the marketing channels, which was, everybody loves this wild and crazy artwork and this new tone that's in the game. We want more stuff like that. And obviously there's only so much that you can do with a role-playing thing before you oversaturate the market. So they said, well, we wanted to do another card game. Let's link it to that. And we can use all that gorgeous art and keep all those fans happy and, you know, add some new stuff to it. I don't know whose idea it was to link it with the Blood War, other than it had to be a Planescape product, and we needed to have some excuse for this to be a battle card game. So by the time it got to my desk, I was told, this is a Planescape card game. It has to be about the blood war between the, at the time, they were the Tanari versus the Beatazu instead of the devils versus the demons. You know, we can go into that whole history as to why that.
Well, to separate, basically the short story is to separate it from any sort of real world theology, I guess.
Well, that, and it was also another step to you know, not have to keep fighting some of the legal or at least PR battles from the tail end of the satanic panic of the 80s and early 90s. So in any case, so I get tapped mainly because I had room in my schedule and they said, okay, so we need a card game that's kind of like Magic or Spellfire, but not, and it needs to be about the blood war. And beyond that, well, you know, you've got 2.5 weeks. Have something ready for playtest by this time next week.
That's an unbelievable statistic, considering something like Magic the Gathering was in 2.5 years of like pre-production and development. So tell me how you approached such a mammoth task.
At that point, remember, this is, oh gosh, I had been hired in 1990 as an editor. And I'd only, at that point, recently been moved over to design work. I got moved over to design work partly because I was having to do a lot of editing work that was rewriting a lot of stuff that was coming in from freelancers or whatever. And so I said, if I've got to do this much work, I want my name on the cover. I don't want to be, you know, the guy hidden away on the inside. I want, you know, if I'm going to have to do this much work, I want to get the kudos for it or the abuse, either way. So, you know, before that, I had done the last product in the Marvel line, which was Avengers Archives. And before that was the City of Splendors box for Forgotten Realms, which that was more of a heavy edit thing of, let's take everything that Ed had previously produced for it, and then I'll fill in any gaps. so, you know, in any case, this is still pretty early in my game design career, but I sat down and then proceeded to spend, you know, 8 to 10 hours a day playing Spellfire and Magic. And by the end of day one, because I had been playing the games previously, I realized that I wanted Blood Wars to be a multiplayer game, not just a two-player game. Because, well, these other two games, how do we make it different? We make it so it's more than just two people at the table.
So that's so fascinating because, I mean, at the time, I mean, there wasn't, like you said, many collectible card games in the market. I mean, there was 11 before Blood Wars came out, and only one of those really lent heavily into the multiplayer thing, which was Jihad and later renamed Vampire the Eternal Struggle from Wizards of the Coast. And you guys sort of wanted to make your mark. Now, I always wondered, was that motivation as well in part because role-playing gaming groups are so many more people than you would sort of have from a sort of Magic gaming group, which is just one versus one?
Maybe it was in the back of my head that I wanted it to be a little bit more role-playing, but it really was as simple as if all these other games are two-player, let's do something that's three or more. You can still play it with two players, but it works better. It honestly works best at four players. You can go up to six, but then it gets a little crazy.
So I was going to ask then, just to lead on from there, obviously you said, you know, you were stuck in this room, you were playing Magic, you were playing Spellfire, you were playing Magic, you were playing Spellfire. There wasn't a ton of other things to sort of look at the time, but what I feel like Blood Wars does is it really innovates in some really interesting ways. But before we jump into the innovations, let's talk what's similar. There is very, honestly, very few similarities to Magic, and only a couple that is similar to, say, Spellfire. Like Spellfire is over, you know, fighting over realms, or in your case, for Blood Wars, battlegrounds. Was that something that was intentional to sort of make it familiar to the already player base that Spellfire had?
Yeah, I think that was a big part of it. And, you know, I didn't have a huge amount. I couldn't reinvent the wheel given the deadline I had. So I said, okay, what works best with each, I was kind of going in and cherry picking from the games I was looking at and what worked best that I liked that I wanted to pull in. And since I knew this had to be about the Blood War, okay, that's always been, you know, about extraplanar territories. So whether we're talking about, you know, the nine hells or whatever, okay, we're going to have them fight over whatever battlefields. And I started looking through all the artwork and all the stuff in Planescape. That was the other thing, was I dipped in and looked at Planescape, but just like everybody else on staff, you didn't really have time to sit down and read everything cover to cover unless it was part of your workday. And it was on, you know, nobody read a complete manuscript unless you were editing it. So, you know, in that short time, okay, I've been skipping through and looking at it and enjoying a lot of the Planescape stuff. I had to sit down and really absorb a lot of the terminology and a lot of the stuff that they'd set up. But that was useful because it pretty much gave me every proper name that I would need for all the warlords, all the battlefields, and a lot of the troops that became part of the game. But yeah, I would say that the realms from Spellfire were definitely part of, okay, this is what we're fighting over, is we're trying to, you know, conquer these battlefields. And, you know, okay, we don't have to take it that much further than that, you know, other than how you're going to conquer those things. And that's where, you know, I like to think we came up with some new stuff.
That's awesome. Well, I think you did actually capture some amazing mechanical stuff, and I do want to dig into that. But let's detour for a second, because you mentioned in there sort of immersing yourself in the Planescape world. You mentioned that, you know, you were trying to learn the names and trying to learn the lore. And something I think that that Blood Wars did that was different to Spellfire is it sort of immersed itself in a narrative, something that TSR was really, really well known for. And, you know, something that really Magic wasn't doing. You know, if you weren't paying very close attention, Magic's storyline seemed like it was just jumping from set to set to set, and there was no really cohesive plan as far as narrative goes. But tell me, you shared a document with me earlier, which I'll post and link in the comments, but tell me about what your approach to Blood Wars was from a narrative perspective before we jump back to the mechanical stuff.
Yeah, since I knew that we'd have a very short window, if it was planned to be 2 years, 1 year, however, I think we initially plotted it out and said this is more than likely going to be a very limited 2 year run for this game. So I plotted it out for, you know, the core release and then the six booster packs, of which we only produced three out of the six, but I'd actually plotted and planned most of the other three that never got produced. But I went through and said, okay, if we're doing this, let's tell a story with it. And so with each of the booster packs, rather than just following the theme format that Magic was doing, which is, okay, now we're going to do dark stuff, now we'll do Arabian Nights, and now we'll do this. I decided, okay, the Blood War has been going on forever. So the first pack was, okay, we're escalating for whatever reason. So it's the first pack and the initial release is all the standard stuff that you would have expected, even if you just read the stuff that the first time I remember reading it was way back in Unearthed Arcana in the mid 80s. Since I knew that the second pack was expanding into other, realms isn't the right word, planes, and different dimensions, we made that part of both the title and the kind of behind the scenes story. It gave us something to talk about in ad copy. The war is expanding. And then the third pack was a lot of the godly powers and their worshipers. So, okay, now the Blood Wars is, they're going after the gods in their realm. So it gave us the excuse to throw Hercules and Zeus and Poseidon and a whole bunch of different things in, and not just, you know, Greek and Roman.
Yeah, but no, other deities as well and stuff like that.
So yeah, the plots would have continued on, and like I said, and it's in that memo that I found and shared with you. And I was just tired of a lot of empty sales copy that didn't really tell you anything other than, look, it's new, come get it. You know, it's like, okay, how about if we actually put some story into it? I didn't see it as world building at the time, but in retrospect, yeah, there was a bit more of that than I'd even realized I was doing. But it's even in just adding names to places and things and people.
Well, something that I found really fantastic and really innovative about Blood Wars, and it's not something that I feel like the market really understood at the time. You know, we're talking about building in these stories. We're talking about sort of, you know, layering them in this foreshadowing that we'll see. And I even love the fact that booster packs weren't called booster packs. They were called escalation packs because the war is literally escalating every time that there's a release.
I forgot that. Thank you.
Well, like I said, I think it's great, great immersive storytelling. You know, when you put it in this market of games that sort of aren't really held up for their story, unlike TSR's other releases, which are basically all story-based, it sort of gets lost in the, no pun intended, the shuffle of things. So I really do love that you guys obviously put that extra effort in. The other thing I wanted to mention, and this is sort of leaning back into the mechanics, and we're going to sort of come back to that, but there was a lot of things in on the cards that weren't really relevant upon its first release. But again, that was all basically foreshadowing for gameplay. Instead of foreshadowing a story, you were foreshadowing gameplay. Things like, you know, home realms and other attributes that cards would have that didn't really make sense if you just bought the very first, you know, the first sets and things that just felt like it was extra words on cards. But I really love that you were sort of digging in and sort of putting these elements in that sort of came into play as sets and stories sort of evolved. Tell me a little bit more where that inspiration came from and why that was the idea you wanted to approach.
Some of it was strictly from the card design, and just, well, a lot of it was also from just following the Planescape model, which was have a little bit of attitude with the characters, with the art, with the text, not just have it be the only time you actually hear a character speak is in box text introduced by the dungeon master. Now, there's always a lot, you know, little snippets, little quotes here and there. And so we pulled in a lot of that stuff for the cards, especially when you didn't necessarily need it for a card rule, you know, to fill up the space. I mean, this this is some old school. Yeah. Early on, you know, the rough idea of how we were laying out the cards.
So for those listening, what he's showing is like blueprints for the actual card layout. It looks really amazing. I mean, I suggest anyone listening to this audio jumps onto the YouTube version, which will be linked in the description, and check that out.
Yep. I will try and get you a scan of that in the next couple of days. But I've got this. Yeah, this one was, I think I managed to Photoshop this together about 2 weeks after I'd started. So this was my first pitch as to how I wanted it to look. And then obviously they made it a lot prettier than I made it.
That looks like it has a lot of the essence of what ended up coming out with Blood Wars in it. And something we didn't really talk about, let's jump back to the mechanics a little bit. Visually, the game is really arresting, but something that's really interesting as well is it really ties to D&D by having sort of a bunch of things that really lead into D&D sort of rules for fans of D&D. Something that Spellfire really didn't do. For example, I just saw on that, on that blueprint you showed me, it very clearly has pronounced sort of a character or a legion's or a warlord's alignment. That was something you wanted to include in the game, was it?
Yeah, because I needed ways to make sure that, you know, there were reasons for everybody to do what they were doing. And I can't remember if I came up with that or someone else did. It was such a chaotic process that while I can lay claim to a lot of the skeletal stuff, there's a lot of muscles put on that skeleton that were added by other people, whether it was my editor, Lester Smith, or, you know, all the people that were in our product group at the time and lots of the play testers. And in fact, someone else that I know you've talked to, John Jackson Miller, who used to be with Krause. He and Brent Frankenhoff at Krause were some of our early playtesters for Blood Wars early on as well.
In fact, yeah, John talks about that in the episode that that we did together as well.
Ah, and I haven't watched that episode, but I will soon. So, but yeah, the alignment, it seemed to be that was an easy construct I could pull off because it allowed me to use both the good and the evil sides, because I realized maybe 2 days into it that if I were strictly keeping it to just the demons versus devils, this wouldn't even be enough of a concept to, you know, hold up the initial release, let alone anything beyond that. So I said, okay, the main difference between the demons and devils was law versus chaos. Okay, well, let's embrace that and add in the neutrality. So we've got all the nine alignments to work with. And that gave me something that I could fold all the warlords and the legions to. It was an easy combination to work with.
I think it's a brilliant idea, sort of like almost playing off sort of the color pie and Magic. You know, they had sort of their different factions, and obviously alignment charts are something that are so integral to the D&D experience. You know, it's something that a player, you know, even if they haven't learned how to play the game, is something that they're almost familiar with from day one. So I think it was a great way to mechanically tie original D&D into this card game. Now let's talk about mechanics a little bit, because as I mentioned before, Blood Wars, by my count, and I can't 100% lock this number down, but I believe it was about the 11th or 12th, probably 12th collectible card game to hit the US market, depending on the way that you count them. But there was a few things in there, and I can't say this definitively, but that I think really started with Blood Wars that became big in other games. So for example, mechanically, you had something called RR, which would stand for random result, where you'd pull a card from the top of the deck and it would tell you a specific number. And that would be your result for, you know, randomizing, essentially the equivalent of rolling a dice in Dungeons and Dragons. But of course, because you're deck building, you can sort of influence what cards are going to pop up and at what rate. So this is something that shows up in other collectible card games, like the Star Wars collectible card game later uses it, and many other card games afterward. Was that something that you remember where the inspiration for that kind of random result mechanic sort of came from, or anything like that?
There were times that we just needed a random number as either an answer to an attack or some other effect. And since we didn't want to bother with, suddenly telling them, okay, you need to have a D10 at hand to roll. It's like, you know, I've already got these, the strength of the cards. Why don't I just use, you know, we can just make it a factor of 10. So if something has a strength of 4, the random number is going to be 6. So, you know, yes, the more powerful the card is directly, the less powerful it'll be as a random. But it was just one more thing that I wish I could say that, yes, this was my brilliant plan all along, but it was more one of those, well, I've got this, and I was always looking to make sure it was balanced both ways, however you would need to use something. So, you know, we never had more lawful stuff than chaotic stuff. We never had more good than evil and so forth. And in the same sense, I just decided, okay, if I need a numerical value for a card, I'll just have a counter value that's, you know, so if we need it for a random number, we've got it.
Well, historically speaking, in the collectible game space, that is just revolutionary, because it provides this bizarre lever that you hadn't seen, well, that you hadn't seen in things like Magic, or to a lesser extent, Spellfire, because essentially it means that you can basically make a card without a resource cost, because the resource cost really is having a really good card in your deck means you're going to get really low random results. And I think that that's really quite revolutionary for the space, especially considering it ended up getting used not just in Star Wars, but in a bunch of other Decipher games and plenty of other collectible card games there within.
Yeah, I was just trying to think of what were the other card games I was looking at the time, and, you know, just at the same time of when Blood Wars came out. And honestly, the only one that was leaping to mind, Wing Commander, I think might have been later. I remember playing the Highlander card game and a couple of things like that. So they had, you know, there were lots of licensed IPs that suddenly had card games, and, well, let's admit it, some were better than others, and yeah, some actually embraced their IP, and some were a very odd combo. But I'll be kind and not say.
Well, that is definitely a space I live in, and I cannot relate to that statement more. But just moving on with the mechanics of specifically Blood Wars a little bit more, and speaking to the idea that maybe we're leaning into the mechanics, the IP or something like that, let's sort of have a look at the mechanical side, because it does something that's really interesting that, again, I can't say for 100% sure, but I don't think any of the 11 games before it did this. It operated with two hands, which was there was a combat hand and a command hand. So essentially, you could be playing basically certain cards to your commander or your warlord in this particular case, and then having other cards fill your hand. And it's a really interesting idea that comes up later in that same year in a couple of different games, namely the Guardian CCG. Do you know where the whole two-handed idea came from?
I honestly cannot remember. I think it may have been nothing more than, okay, if we're trying to build an army, I need to be able to have more than, I don't want that to totally occupy my hand. I want that to be able to react to other things. But if I'm needing to defend something, some territory, I want to be able to have an army to put into that. So I think it may have been nothing more than I need to be able to put cards down on the table that are defensive in nature to keep the stuff I've already conquered.
It's so interesting you say that. Obviously, it was just a design necessity, and perhaps these other games I'm talking about felt that same way. And in seeing this parallel design in the space is really, really interesting to see. So we sort of designed this game. Blood Wars is sort of basically TSR's second collectible card game, and it hits the market only, as I mentioned before, 9 months after Spellfire ended up launching. So tell me, you hit the market with Blood Wars. What do you remember about that launch, and what feedback do you remember getting from the audience? Because it is such a different game from the other things in the market at the time.
Gosh, I know that we got rushed out to a couple of conventions, and so yeah, I had a whirlwind couple of weeks where I was hitting a different convention every weekend. The one that's sticking in my mind was in it was west of Boston in Massachusetts. I can't remember exactly which town it was in, but we had a lot of fun, especially since, you know, we had been out for maybe a week at that point. And so we're bringing in, you know, we've got still a lot of playtest cards mixed in with some of our other, you know, the stuff that's actually been produced. And, but we had a blast with that, that first weekend, because, you know, it was still fairly new. But so we had to do a little cajoling to get people to sit down and play with us. But once you got them to play once, every single group I think that I had to cajole into playing came back at least once or twice more the rest of that weekend to try it out again. They were just waiting for there to be a gap at the table to sit down and play.
Well, again, it's such a novel idea. You know, I mean, obviously we mentioned before that there was Jihad, but that was a little bit more cutthroat, whereas Blood Wars was the multiplayer CCG, whereas nothing else had really existed in that space previously.
Yeah, I think in some ways that weekend definitely showed me that my editor was more right than I knew.
How so?
When I was designing it, the bulk of what I was constantly focusing on was keeping it balanced and keeping everything even. So, you know, you never have too much of any one thing or of any one type of thing. But once Lester got a hold of it, and he's a far more, he thinks outside the box a bit more than I did at the time.
We're talking about iconic D&D author Lester Smith.
Yeah, he pointed out to me after, I think he'd had it for a day or so, he's like, you know, this is a very solid design, but how you've written these things, you can interpret this several ways. And so cards that I designed to be strictly defensive, he sat down and played me through a game and showed me that this can be used offensively. You know, even if it's, I mean, some of them I expected, like there's, you know, there's one fate card that suddenly you go from, this is a combat battle to, nope, it's going to be decided politically, which will pretty much throw out all the strength that the combat person brings to.
Oh, was that a major transformation or something like that?
Something like that. I can't remember and don't want to waste time looking digging for it. But yeah. Yeah, that's, but there were some cards that I had honestly designed to be a defense, and Lester was showing me ways that they could be used offensively. And so yes, there were definitely some ways that I suddenly realized I'd created a monster. But honestly, it made it a vastly better game to leave the phrasing and everything just the way it was, because it really then would depend on who you were playing with and how they liked to play would color how they approached the game, which was fine. I mean, it still had the internal balance. It's just that there were a lot more unexpected shifts than I'd planned into the game anyway.
It's really fascinating to hear that, because obviously with collectible games, what you can see is, you know, people are always going to try that sort of cutthroat sort of win condition. But what I'm like about Blood Wars is, I guess it's sort of like a D&D game, you know, because it's this multiplayer game, people can sort of, like what Magic's Commander format is doing nowadays, can sort of decide the power level that they want to sort of play at the time that they want to. You know, it was, and obviously these degenerate sort of cards can be used and these combos can come out, but at the same time, it gives a lot of room for players to explore. I think that's really cool.
Well, thanks. Yeah.
Well, I do have a couple of questions for you, because obviously, you know, Blood Wars hits the market. What do you think are some of the challenges that it faces in the market? Obviously, people are famously know that 1995 was a, for lack of a better term, a deluge of new collectible card games. But what's your perspective as the designer and somebody who shepherded the product through to market?
Oh, I, like I said, in some ways, it was better that I kept the blinders on and just kept focused on the product when I was working on it. But once we got sent out and we're doing the conventions and, you know, okay, I start just wandering the floor and suddenly, you know, everywhere you turn, oh, here's another CCG. Oh, here's one all about some combination of dragons and puppies, I think. Here's something to do with a candy store. Yeah, not buying that one. Whatever. But yeah, you could not swing a dead cat without hitting a new CCG at the time. And I don't know if it was by nature of timing or marketing or whatever it may be, but Blood Wars sold incredibly well for its initial print run. Unfortunately, I think that management dragged its feet in getting a second print run out to the market, and the bottom dropped out quite a bit in terms of, we had a ton of demand, and we weren't filling it because they were, oh, well, no, we were, they had already started working on, I'm not sure if they were starting on Dragon Dice then and were holding up on some printing deal, or I don't know. I don't always remember the details in the correct order, but there was some business reason as to why they had to wait for, like, instead of, you know, getting a print run going right now when all these things are hot. They waited 2 months or 3 months, I can't remember. And by then, you know,
something else had come along. Another puppies and kitties game had come along.
Yeah. So, you know, I think they missed the window in terms of keeping Blood Wars as big as it might have been.
So that's so fascinating to hear, because actually I had an earlier guest on who in 1995 released another collectible game, the aforementioned Guardian CCG, and they said the same thing. They said the thing that caught them most off guard was the fact that they weren't ready to meet demand. So it's so interesting to hear your story. So, you know, so many people look at the 1995 year as the crash because collectible games flooded the market, but perhaps it wasn't that they flooded the market, it's that they enticed the market and then sort of withdrew, unintentionally, because they didn't have this backup ready to go.
Well, yeah, I mean, in some ways, the CCG market, the scarcity was in some ways always part of it, because Magic taught everybody, and Magic was the example everybody was following, and if they weren't necessarily producing enough to meet all their demand and such that the prices were going crazy and they weren't, you know, producing enough to fulfill every order. That was part of, in some ways, not the game per se, but the way the market was being approached. But yeah, it definitely came down to, if you're not going to produce material when we're begging for it, we're going to go check out these 17 other things that we can do. So I think, you know, it's, I mean, we had enough interest and investment that we did the first year, and that's, I think, where they pulled the plug, mainly because, yeah, by then the crash was obvious, even to people who didn't believe in the products to begin with.
Right. So it's so interesting to hear that, and just like the market factors. I'm sure you're not too clued into it, but there's a similar sort of trading card game or collectible card game renaissance going on at the moment with Kickstarter and stuff like that. But we won't get into that now. What I did want to ask is, you mentioned rarity in there and scarcity in there. And what's something that I know a lot of players felt, especially when this first escalation pack for Blood Wars rolled around, was that it was too many rare cards, not enough common cards. Do you want to speak to that? Was that something that TSR insisted on doing, you know, more chase, more rarity, less common, less uncommon cards, to sort of make it more of a quest to fill out these sets?
I honestly don't know if I've got enough of the knowledge, because everything that I knew about how to set up the rarity and so forth was taught to me by Jim Ward and how they set it up for Spellfire. So it was, you know, we had, I think it was, what, 5 press sheets? There were, I'd have to go back and look on the details, but I know that the, you know, this little lady right here was only on, she was 1 card out of 100, and that was one of the press sheets out of maybe 6 or 8. So she only shows up 1 out of every 800 cards.
So for those listening, just listening to the audio version of this, he's just flashed the game's arguably rarest card and most iconic card, Lady of Pain, which was an incredibly rare chase card that fetches hundreds and hundreds of dollars on the secondary market, even today.
Really? How many of these do I have?
You must start planning a vacation then.
I don't know if I've got that many, but yeah. But yeah, it pretty much, I was told that, oh, I mean, I even have some files that say, okay, this is how many, these are the common cards, uncommon, the rare, and then the ultra rare and the chase cards. So I was planning it that way. And so yeah, the Game Buster cards are definitely the ones that are the ultra rares and the chases. So we didn't have to worry too much about, you know, banning them from a game competition or something like that, because they were, you know, showing up too often. It's like, no, they're not going to show up that often. but we definitely wanted to make sure that they were something that people might want, but also that they were special, so they were worth the hunt to getting them. You know, I had absolutely no control over how they printed and how it all got distributed. All I know is that, you know, mathematically, this should be showing up out of every, you know, X number of packs. And that's all I could do was work it in as to how often it was going to show up on the print sheet and how often that would get shuffled into a pack.
Understandably, because the interesting thing there is, obviously, you know, you as the game designer have no particular way as how this, you know, rarity is part of the marketing scheme, essentially, you know. And like I said, that first set had like 40-ish uncommons and commons and 90-ish rares. So obviously players felt like it was very hard to sort of build a set with so many, you know, chasing cards when it was such a small card pool to begin with. Now, the question I do want to ask is, speaking to distribution and stuff like that, something that was really interesting about Blood Wars is you had this very interesting, very unique, again, mechanically minded way of sort of deck construction. There was a point system where different cards could go in a different set and you had to sort of fulfill these different requirements when you were building a deck. However, the decks themselves, the starter decks, didn't follow that structure in its own way. Do you want to talk to how you felt that might have affected the game, and if maybe pre-constructed decks might have done a little bit more for the game than what actually came out of the randomized starter decks that you had.
Yeah, I like I said, the initial release was sorry, I got to reach around the computer here. I wish I had one of the rule books, but yeah, when you initially bought the game, you would get a double deck, and it was set up with a little thing to sit on a rack, but and it had the rule book that would fit behind it. So it was a tiny little thing, but yeah, the fact that they were randomly assembled decks, I think we did manage to set it up so you could play with them, but yeah, they weren't great, you know, just straight out of the box. And in some ways, I think Magic had the same problem at that time, which was, yeah, if you didn't plan for a particular, you know, a pre-constructed deck, you weren't going to have the greatest experience right off the bat. But all we could do was, with the information that we had, was okay, we'll just have to try and our best that they'll be able to play. It may not be perfect, but they'll be able to play. And you know, then, but that will, you know, urge them to want to pick up a couple of extra packs so they can then build a real deck from it. The fact that we were shipping two decks, it made it, because I don't think any of the other games at the time were trying to ship a full thing so you could have, you know, one purchase would be enough for two players to at least attempt the game. Everybody, you know, previous to that, your own thing, but this one was definitely intended for, okay, well, you and one other person can actually, you know, play right after you break the shrink wrap. But yeah, like with all the CCGs, it gets better once you can start fine-tuning it and making sure you have exactly what you need.
Well, indeed. And that was really the nature of collectible card games in those early days with the randomized starters and stuff like that. And it's so funny that you guys, you know, built out this amazing multiplayer experience, but unfortunately, maybe perhaps from product planning or something like that, then delivered it to people in a two-player format, which I think is a great idea and really revolutionary, but it's a bit of a shame that you sort of see that there's that disconnect there in the way that the game could be experienced through the way that people are first experiencing it.
Yeah. it's hard for me to remember all the particulars. Like I said, there, you know, it was a blur in how short a time we had to throw it all together, and it was blind panic. But I think, you know, the fact that we're still talking about it nearly 30 years later tells me, well, I must have done something right somewhere in this process.
I absolutely agree with that statement. I think you did do something right. And I think that Blood Wars is certainly one of the games that I feel like might have slipped through the cracks of that time. But I do encourage anybody to go back and check out the game. It's, you know, it's still easy to pick up and sort of get into it. And I really do like it as this sort of multiplayer experience, especially considering, as I mentioned before, you know, Magic has a commander format where it's all about multiplayer and sort of that political side. I really feel like it sort of captures that charm. Perhaps the game was just ahead of its time. But I do want to ask a question about, you know, you mentioned before that you started planning out these sets, not just, you know, you also mentioned how short a time it was. To be honest with you, I think the initial Blood Wars release comes out in March, and then the third escalation pack comes out by August. So essentially we're talking about 5-month period there for the entirety of the game as far as market release goes. But you actually had planned beyond that. You know, you said you had planned for storylines and other, you know, in instances of other escalation packs, 4, 5, and 6, especially. What do you remember about those sets? What do you remember about designing those sets, and how far along the process did you get?
Well, let's see. The third pack, like we said, that was the Godly Plane. So you're invading Olympus, or you're invading Hades, or whatever. The fourth pack was going to be the inner planes and the astral plane. So we'd be throwing in, if you remember, the other great war amongst the lawful versus the chaotic of the Githzerai and the Githyanki from the old, oh crud, I can see the cover and I'm blanking on the title, The Fiend Folio. So that was that 82? I can't remember. Yeah, in any case, so that was, the fourth pack was going to be the inner and outer planes. Pack five was going to be, if I'm remembering my theme correctly, that was going to be less of a battlefields and people and a lot more stuff, a lot more fate cards and a lot more just weaponry, with the idea that, okay, now that you've invaded the astral plane and the inner planes, the arcane from Spelljammer and some of the other known weapons dealers of of the planes were getting involved. And that was the whole shtick for that thing, was going to be just a lot more stuff to upset the apple cart in how you were getting used to playing it. And the sixth pack that I'd set up was the Lady of Pain bringing the hammer down and getting this war back under control. So there would be ways to I can't remember how far in with those things, but there were a lot of cards that were going to specifically neuter previous regular use tactics. So, you know, anything, you know, it would more heavily, you know, just keep the battle. The whole story idea behind it was the Lady of Pain and Sigil is taking back control, and we are locking the Blood War back into the original five planes it started in. And so there would have been, I think I had some cards that would allow you to either steal or just destroy battlefields that had already been claimed, which obviously affects the way the game gets played too. So that was the gist of it, was, you know, you started with the initial pack and it's escalating. And then we close out the story by saying, no, you're going back to square one. We're only going to allow this fight to be the demons and the devils on their five planes, and that's it. And so
that's amazing. That threading of mechanics and story and narrative was also innovative for that time, and I'm so excited to hear that. And I'm actually really disappointed that we never got to see that element of the game, because it feels like it was so fleshed out. You know, like we said earlier, you were building out these sort of themes on the cards that really weren't going to pay off until later sets. And I feel like that would have been an amazing sort of like a ring cycle of sorts to the way that the game played.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In fact, I think the question I got 70% of the time at the initial release of Blood Wars was, I think one of the early cards was the Demon Web Pits as a battlefield. And everybody was mad that they couldn't collect Lolth, the Spider Queen, as the warlord for that battlefield. And she's not in the game yet. Wait, please. And she eventually did. You know, that was, again, it was all planned ahead of time, since I had that tight deadline. But I was I was a pit bull and holding on to the idea of, everything's going to have a balance. So even if it doesn't seem like it's ready yet, it will eventually have the counterbalance to that. And so I knew I had all the godly cards coming out in pack three. So we may put some of those battlefields up early if I needed to have them in the game earlier, that sort of thing.
Well, that's amazing. In the introduction, I called you a master world builder. And I meant in that particular instance, a master world builder in the role-playing game sense. But now, hearing all of this plot that you had laid throughout the mechanics of the game and stuff like that, I'm going to add a collectible card game world builder as well to that accolade.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for that and just giving me this insight. Now, it really does disappoint me, especially talking about it now, that we never got to see the extent of that world building plan. Now, my question then is, when did you first hear that Blood Wars wasn't going to go any further, wasn't going to hit that sixth set that you had sort of mapped out? Tell me about hearing about that and sort of what you know about Blood Wars cancellation and perhaps why Blood Wars fell by the wayside, while at the time, the other TSR collectible card game, Spellfire, continued.
I think there's a couple of reasons. I can't say much directly because, as the guy down in the trenches, by the time the decision was made to pull the plug, I was already buried eyeball deep in some other project. But I think part of the reason that Spellfire continued, but Blood Wars got waylaid was the fact that the bloom was off the rose in terms of Planescape. Planescape's numbers were starting to dwindle a little bit. It was not, by that point, the hot property that it started out as, and which is, you know, that should have been expected, but that was part of it. It was also, Blood Wars was seen more as a Planescape add-on rather than its own thing, which Spellfire was. And also, the designer of Spellfire was a vice president of the company. I was not.
I can understand why that might sway the decisions in the boardroom.
Just a little bit, anyway. But yeah, I think it came down to, they made the decision of, well, we can keep pumping money into this and do more stuff, but you know, because by then they'd done another print run, but the numbers were not as strong as they were wanting them to be, and they might have been stronger had they been 3 months previous, whatever. I this is all, you know, inside baseball, but it just I can't really predict or say, because I wasn't in the room, but you know, I suspect it was more, Spellfire was still delivering better numbers, even with any reductions from competition. So they decided, let's keep our money over here and we'll let this go away. Because, you know, even if we did have a plan, it's like, well, we're seeing diminishing returns on this. So since the other difference was Spellfire could keep using other pickup art that had been previously used elsewhere, we'd pretty much picked every single piece clean of available Planescape art. So we were having to buy more art than initially. So that increased the cost, which reduces the profits. So, you know, that's an easy math problem I can figure out.
Well, of course, that's going to paint a target on the back of Blood Wars, because you are creating this original art, and sometimes amazingly, as we saw before. So, you know, Blood Wars falls by the wayside, but it's not an exact shock to the market. There was many collectible card games that were sort of falling by the wayside, but we're sort of leading in from that post sort of 95, sort of that 96 period where TSR, and by all means, we don't have to talk about it if you don't want to, but TSR starts to go through a bit of a turbulent time, and things start to change within the company. So after Blood Wars sort of falls by the wayside, you're still working, like you said, on other projects and stuff like that. Tell me about your personal experience as TSR starts to become a more notable sort of business issue, as things start to look like they're starting to crumble internally. Do you have any perspective or any stories in that particular side of things?
I have some stories. I'll keep a couple of them to myself.
Fair enough, obviously.
I'm one of the worst people to ask of, well, what was going on at the time? Mainly because, like I've said, I slapped on the blinders and strictly focused on what was the project right in front of me. So unless things were making a huge noise, I didn't tend to notice it.
Understandable, yeah.
Now, I do remember the day that some of the layoffs were happening, but honestly, I didn't notice. I had a tendency at the time, I'd be in the office around 6 or 6:30 in the morning, and I'd be just working until sunset. And so I didn't notice anything going on until I heard the editor in the cube next to me start crying loudly enough that it attracted my attention. And suddenly I start realizing that there's people leaving with cardboard boxes. And so it was a tough couple of years, because there were some times where we weren't sure if we were getting paid on payday or not. And you know, they unfortunately had a tendency to cut people loose right before Christmas, which is the worst time for a lot. And but so I'm not going to name names. It's just I managed to weather through somehow. I don't know why. You know, I wasn't doing any better or worse work than some people, but I seem to, you know, manage to stay afloat. And until Peter Atkinson and Wizards bought TSR, I would have been just after my birthday, about 97. So this is mid to late May of 97 that we got purchased. And they offered me the same job that I had at TSR with about a 33% raise. I said, yes, sir, how high?
And that involved moving out to Seattle with Wizards of the Coast, did it?
Yep, I just had to get myself out there. They were going to handle moving, you know, muscles and whatnot, but I had to get myself and any immediate material I would need, you know. So it was pretty much empty my office into my car with a cat and drive west.
That's such a unique perspective in gaming history. It's something, as I mentioned earlier, or have mentioned before, is something that's really unique in hobby gaming. Now, tell me about your experience. Did you find it a positive experience going to work for Wizards? How did it affect your day-to-day? Tell me all about your experience as the new TSR / Wizards of the Coast employee.
In some ways, the only thing that changed for a lot of the TSR folks, other than we all got paid better, which was good because it was a bit more expensive living out in Washington than in Wisconsin. But we kept probably at least of the staff that we had by the end. I'd say we kept at least 60% of the people from TSR. A lot of us moved out west. A few didn't, like Jeff Grubb. I know Jim Ward was gone by then, but a few people chose not to take Wizards offer and just, you know, stayed put in the Midwest. But yeah, quite a few of us were out in Seattle, and we were welcomed. It was great. It was certainly a dynamic place, and there were a number of folks that were on staff at Wizards, like Wolfgang Bauer, who had been with us at TSR but had moved out there, and Mike Selinker was one of the early Wizards folks that we'd worked with before as freelancers as well. So the main difference, I think, for us was that we weren't the only R&D staff. There was also the Magic team and so forth. So while we still focused on D&D and our role-playing stuff, the Magic group was definitely, they had a different mindset because they were put together mostly by Richard Garfield. And so a lot of them were all, they were all math geeks, which, you know, it's not surprising given how math and how probability set up the Magic is.
Well, absolutely. And of course, you know, collectible card games like lean into that sort of, you know, more mathematical, more mechanical side. Whereas obviously products like the TSR had put out, you know, Dungeons and Dragons, Spelljammer, you know, all of the ones you've worked on, Marvel, everything like that was a storytelling game. So I can understand that there would be that disconnect there. And I'm so glad that, you know, obviously Peter's love for TSR products, obviously Dungeons and Dragons was something that helped carry you guys over. They could very easily have dropped the entire company and, you know, wiped the entire staff and started over with the product line. But you were one of the lucky few who got to work over with them on relaunching Dungeons and Dragons. Did you have any memories you wanted to share about that particular experience?
Well, yeah, and the build up to 3E, is that what you're, okay. A couple of amusing things. I can remember the first meeting we had where they said, okay, yes, it's official. We're working on third edition. If anyone mentions it publicly, we will deny it publicly and you will be out of the job because we will find out who snitched. But I do remember, you know, the first time I really hit the wall of the difference between how the TSR team was approaching games and how the Magic team, I wish I could remember exactly who it was, but that, you know, we got to talking about, you know, choice of dice for tables and why we use certain dice for certain things. And they're, you know, going through this long litany of, oh, well, this is the probability of this and this and this. And so why did you use a D12 here? Is it because I hadn't seen a D12 used in a couple of years and I like them? So I just decided this is a D12 table. Like, but the probability is that I don't care. I just wanted to use a D12. But, you know, so you know, I never approach things mathematically. I still proudly have a t-shirt that says English major, you do the math.
That's a fantastic slogan.
Like you kindly said, I'm more of a world building guy than I am, you know, the rules lawyer, or even the guy that wants to come up with some of the crunchy bits, as people call it. I'm more worried about keeping a story cohesive than I am about, do these numbers work out correctly? It's like, yeah, you can worry about numbers.
Well, from hearing you tell your tales today, I can definitely agree with that. You've told some amazing stories.
Thank you.
Now, I do want to say very much thank you for that. That sort of wraps up my questions for the interview, but I do have a whole bunch of questions from people in the community that still, like listeners that still play Blood Wars or still play some of the other products you've worked on. So we would love to just put those to you if you're okay with that.
Okay, sure.
So let's move on to the community questions then. And in that case, I'm going to just throw out a name here, Travis Morton. He actually threw a few questions in that I used in the major body part of the intro, the episode. So I do want to say thanks to Travis, but he has a direct question for you about your time working on Blood Wars and everything like that. Do you remember what some of the favorite decks within the offices were for Blood Wars, or any of your personal favorite decks or sort of builds or characters to use in your time building out that game?
Memory, I think if we had, for those just listening at home, I'm holding up a copy of the Blood Wars Warlords Tactical Manual, which is the catalog of all the cards, and it also has two-player rules, but it gives you, there's got to be at least two dozen example decks that you can put together. I suspect that all of the ones that were in common use in the office are probably in this book. So assuming you can get a hold of the PDF or a rare print copy, you know, that those would be the most common ones. I know in the playtest, I would do combat heavy decks. I would do, you know, intrigue heavy decks. I would do the ones that were specifically, you know, for the theme of the game. Okay, this one's going to be all demons. This will be all devils. This one's all angels. This one's all whatever, you know. I think the one that was, for some strange reason, it was the most effective was probably a Modron deck I had for a while. You know, little things like that. But I, you know, it's been a few too many decades. I can't always remember the specifics.
So it's so interesting to hear that even, you know, in your deck building around the office and stuff like that, you kept to that storytelling vibe. You know, you kept in those sort of character-driven sort of motivations when deck building yourself. And I think that that's absolutely great. So I do have another question here from Alexis S, who, and we mentioned him in the intro, but a person whose art is very much involved with Blood Wars was Tony D. Trelizzi. And he had amazing art in that game, some great sketches and stuff like that. Was his work something that was really informed your design, or was that something that came sort of after? Obviously there's the connection with Planescape there, but did you know all of his work would be used the way it was?
I think his work was held up as, you know, that was the high watermark for Planescape and one of the main draws for that line. And therefore we were told, you know, pick up whatever art you want, but pick up everything of Tony's. So, and we even commissioned some new stuff from him. But I know that only because I lucked out and I managed to buy one of the pieces from him. So I only have two pieces of original art from Blood Wars. One is from Janelle Jaques and the other is from Tony.
Mm-hmm. Do you happen to remember what the cards are?
I think it was a Lantern Archon for Tony, and the one from Janelle was, I can't remember the specific one, but it was one of the Barb Devils with a huge battle horn. He's kind of standing in the midst of it as it's wrapping around him and blowing on the horn.
Absolutely. That's fantastic. So I do have my last question from the community, and it is a very simple one, but also a very broad one. And Sam L asks, how did you feel about the differences were between designing a CCG and an RPG? What sort of were the skill sets differences, and what were some of the biggest things that, you know, you sort of struggled with in and of yourself?
So yeah, the main difference between them is if you're doing a card game or a rule supplement, yeah, obviously you've got to be more focused on mechanics and the game balance in that sense. The stuff I prefer working on is obviously the story and the characters and that sort. I do the mechanical stuff, but that's not where my heart is. My heart is always going to be in, and this goes back to me being the comic book fan. I'm going to come up with a way to make the continuity work no matter what. I'm too much of a Roy Thomas fan to not.
Well, that's an amazing way. And I think that that really speaks to your incredible talent as a world builder and as an RPG designer. You know, obviously it's very hard to tell a story when all the pieces of that story are literally shuffled at the start of every game, but you can give people reasons to sort of build out these, you know, you can instruct a dungeon master through the works that you make, Field of Forgotten Realms, for D&D, for any of the role-playing games that you've worked on, and sort of had that sort of intelligent design, so to put it, of the way that the game works. And I think that that's an absolute fascinating and very unique ability, because so many other people, like, you know, your fellow colleagues at Wizards of the Coast, were not minded that way. And it's an amazing and unique skill, to which I'm going to say, I'm sure for many of your fans, thank you so much for sharing it with us.
It's been a blast.
Well, just before we get out of here, let's have a little fun with a segment I like to call Kraken Questions. So in Kraken Questions, what we have here is three colored booster packs. All you've got to do is tell me a color. And what's inside is three common silly questions, completely randomized, that I don't even know what's in them, and one game designery question. So what lightning round booster pack color would you like to go out on there, Stephen?
Oh, let's go with the prominent blue one there.
Blue it is, matches the shirt that you're wearing that I love. For those who can't see it, it's on the audio version. It is a Doctor Strange shirt, and I think it looks amazing. I already commented on it before we started the record. So before we get out of here, let's answer these Kraken questions. All right, Kraken question number one. What is the nerdiest thing you own?
I'm trying. It's hard for me to gauge. I've got way too much nerdy stuff. But
wear it with pride, my friend. But what do you think? Anything from your TSR days or anything like that?
Oh, well, you want to go, if we want to have rarity for nerd stuff, I have one of, I don't know the number of them, but we all have Lorraine Williams, I guess. What year would that have been? That would have been 94 was one of the last big years. Oh yeah, that would have been the 30th anniversary. No, the 20th anniversary of TSR. So I think we all have Waterford Crystal TSR logos that went on our desks. And so that's a fairly nerdy thing to have. I still have mine. I haven't eBayed mine or anything like that.
That's amazing. So we're talking about the circular TSR logo with the dragon on it?
Yep, that's definitely among the nerdier things. I mean,
well, no, that certainly answers the question. I mean, it's literally one of the most iconic, you know, and I'm using heavy quotation marks, nerd companies that has ever existed. One of their keepsakes for employees. I could not argue with that. Now let's go to the second common question of the Kraken Questions booster pack. A little bit more of a simple one, I guess, depending on your knowledge of the franchise, but you've just become a Jedi. What color is your lightsaber?
Oh, green.
Classic Luke.
Yeah, well, you know, favorite color. I don't know what you know, focus they've assigned to it in the interim, but I know that, you know, when I think of them, I think the original movie. So it's, your choices are blue and red, and then you get green by the Jedi movie. So I always like the green one best. Yeah,
I'm not going to argue with that one. So the next one is, other than your hometown, what is your favorite city?
Oh, gosh. I probably had more fun in the city of York, England, the one time I got there. Yeah, I enjoyed York almost more than I enjoyed London.
Wow. Awesome answer. I mean, it's an outlier for sure.
But yeah, that one, I think of that. I had a lot of fun with that vacation. And York definitely stands out in my mind.
Well, I mean, I'm yet to get to the UK. My plan was to go there, but COVID obviously shut that down. But I'll certainly keep York in mind when I get to that wonderful isle.
Okay.
So the last question for the Kraken question set is, what is your least favorite thing about collectible card games?
I can't have all of them.
Isn't that the struggle, right? Having to get it all at once?
Honestly, yeah, from a play standpoint and just from a game design standpoint, I'd say the toughest part is when you've got a game design that obviously is expecting you to have, you know, parts 1, 2, and 3 for this to work at its best. And if they're too rare, I'm sorry, but that's a game design fail, in my opinion. If you have to, you know, spend more money than you initially did in order for the game to work correctly, you failed.
As a collectible game enthusiast, I couldn't agree more with that philosophy. You know, it's a mistake that had many companies have made throughout the years and is still being made to this very day.
Oh, well.
And it is the trouble of the collectible card game niche, you know. So thank you so much for joining me, Stephen. This has been an absolute tremendous experience to hear about your experiences, not just with Blood Wars, but in gaming in general. It's been absolutely amazing to hear the passion that you have for the entire industry and obviously the work that you've put into it. You know, you mentioned 60-hour work weeks and stuff like that, and nobody would do that unless they absolutely loved what they were doing.
Yep. Well, thanks again for having me. This has been a blast to get all nostalgic.
Trust me, getting nostalgic is my first gear. It's a space I love to live in. Now, before we get out of here, maybe tell people where you can find you online. You know, I follow your amazing Twitter account, and also you have a great website. Tell people all about that.
Okay. Well, I'm spending too much time on Twitter at Stephen E. Schend. I've also got my website, which is stephenyschend.com. That I need to get more active on again, and I hope to. I keep struggling with, do I want to have people be able to comment if I do blog posting? But I've crashed 2 sites because Russian spammers have decided to assault things. So it's, in some ways, it's easier to just say, you know what? I'm not going to have comments here. If you need to ask me a question, I am always looking in at candlekeep.com. They have message boards, and there's actually one where you can drop me questions. So that's easy enough. And that's there's a lot more role-playing stuff there, but I've answered some questions about card games and other stuff there. So if people really need to reach me, yeah, you can find me on Twitter. You can probably find me on Facebook, though I'm not on there as often as some people would like me to be. I really need to get my own website going, and I'm getting back into doing some more freelance editing and development through Reedsy.com. And so if anybody has manuscripts or game stuff that they want me to possibly edit it, approach me through that portal. It's reedsy.com.
That's awesome. Well, what I'll do is I'll link not only your Twitter, not only your own website, not only Candlekeep, but I'll also link that as well, because I think that's a great way for somebody as experienced as yourself to be able to add some credence to people who are, you know, might be amateur tabletop game designers, role-playing game designers. I think it's a really interesting thing.
I'm sorry. Can I make one more plug?
Oh, absolutely. Please go for it.
Because if I tell enough people about it, it will force me to actually finish the damn thing.
That is the best motivator, other people's pressure.
Yes, and I've got a manuscript. I've actually taught with it about 3 or 4 different times, and I'm going to turn it into a book I'm tentatively calling Words into Worlds, and it'll be a world building guide. That because I'm a sucker for buying books about writing, especially for world builders, and I can't tell you how many are just disappointing. Either they start getting towards the stuff that's interesting, and then they just don't go far enough. They don't give you enough detail, and I want to put together at least one book, if not more, that approaches world building the way I was taught it by Jeff Grubb and Ed Greenwood and a couple of others, and the way I've expanded on it. So I'm going to work on that, and I'm hoping to get that out. I originally planned to hopefully have it out by October of this year, but I don't think that's doable. So sometime soon in 2023, if enough people keep browbeating me to get it done.
Well, let's hope that that passion sees its reality. And like I said, everything is going to be linked in the description so that you guys can follow along if you've taken a look at any of Steven's stuff or just enjoyed his conversation and great energy that he has given us today. By all means, check all of that in the description and see everything that he has available and encourage him, browbeat him, as he put it, into presenting this great world building guide. If you're an RPG player, I'm sure it'll be an absolute amazing and useful tome from somebody who has over 30 years experience creating worlds for some of the best role-playing games ever. So thank you guys so much for joining me in this episode. Thank you, of course, to Steven as well. Goodbye from me. Goodbye from you, Steven.
Take care. Thanks for everything.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. And until next time, remember, keep shuffling. And there you have it, our episode with Steven E. Schend, an absolutely amazing designer and amazing person to talk to. I hope you guys enjoyed listening to this episode as much as I enjoyed having that conversation with Steven, who is an absolute great soul and somebody I loved talking to. Thank you so much, of course, to Steven for sharing those stories. And thank you guys, of course, for joining us for this episode. Now, of course, if you're interested in building out a Blood Wars collection, you can go check out our sponsor, which is Category One Games. They have a bunch of Blood Wars cards on their site that it will help you fill out holes in your own collection or even build up a basic collection if you want to try out the game. Or if you want to try any other classic collectible card games, go take a look. They specialize in these old classic collectible games, and they're going to help you put together a deck. They've got great customer service, and their prices are always trying to be timed to the market. So go check them out. Send them an email if you have any questions or anything like that. They will be linked in the description. Now, as for me, I, of course, have been Rands, and this has been The Booster Pack. And if you want to find me online, please do me a favor and follow me on social media or subscribe to this episode. So as for social media, you can find me via Twitter, which is twitter.com/CCG History, which is where you'll find me most, or even on the Facebook page, which is facebook.com/CCG History. I'm a little less active on there, but of course, on both of those mediums, you can send me a direct message if you have something to say. On top of that as well, they have linked in the description a special email address if you want to tell me anything. That is theboosterpack@ccghistory.com. And as well down there, if you look through all of the show notes or the description on the YouTube video, you're going to find our listener survey, which will tell me, you know, the kind of games you want to hear about, the sort of time that you started playing collectible games, and really help me hone the content that you see on this channel to being something that you're a little bit more interested in. So check that out. Let me know of all of that sort of stuff. Now, of course, finally, before we go anywhere, I will ask you, if you like this sort of thing, please subscribe. Whether it's on YouTube or whether it's in the podcast device that you're using, your favorite podcast catcher, hit the subscribe button. We're going to bring you a whole bunch more episodes. They might not all be about Blood Wars, but they're going to be about something to do with collectible trading card games. It has been an absolute joy to bring you this episode, and I really want to continue bringing episodes like this one for games that maybe you love. So not only subscribe, but if you subscribe, or even if you don't, let me know the kind of games you want to hear about and the conversations you want to hear had on this channel. Whether it's a mainline booster pack episode where we talk to a creator of a collectible card game about their work, or if it's on a rare slot episode or a singles episode where I talk about topics that just interest me, possibly either with somebody with some experience in the field or whether it's just me talking, respectively, depending on the episode type. All right, and again, you could do me a huge favor by going back and checking out previous episodes. For example, in this episode, we mentioned a couple of times Jim Ward, who was the head and designer of Spellfire, who was at the company at the time of TSR's release into the collectible card game space. So please go check out that episode if you're interested, or even look through our back catalog and see what else might interest you. There might be another game that you play that you might have never known the history of that we talk about here, or even just a topic relating to collectible games that you might be interested in on our rare slot episodes. Go have a look. I would love to hear your feedback as well. So please comment on YouTube or reach out to me again via those social medias. All right, that's it for me. Thank you so much. I've said it once and I'm going to say it again on this episode, as I always do. Till next time, keep shuffling.